Okay, so I have shown you in the beginning a long and big program of things which I would like to discuss, but obviously there is not enough time for everything. For the full program, probably we would have we would need a semester course instead of four lectures only. So something has to be sacrificed. And I would prefer, and actually I prefer to do the following, to discuss in more detail some conceptual issues of neutrino physics, which are actually rarely discussed at schools and conferences. And to spend less time on the experimental data. So I will have to go very quickly through these experimental results, and I will show instead the summary of them as results of global fit of the neutrino parameters. But still, I hope I'll have some time to discuss at least some of the experimental results and issues in more detail. Okay, now what I'd like to start with, maybe before I start with this. In the last two lectures, I discussed the wave packet approach to the neutrino oscillations. And it may look a little bit involved for those who are not used to it. So the question is, each time we want to calculate the oscillation probability, do we really need to redo all these calculations again to again do all this machinery of wave packets? And the answer is, of course, no. We did it once to make sure that we really obtained the standard formula for this oscillation probabilities under certain conditions. And we can just now use this formula. And the only thing we have to do is to make sure that the conditions for the validity of this formula are satisfied. We don't have to redo all the calculations again and again. And the conditions, as I mentioned before, are the coherence neutrino production, detection, and propagation conditions. In absolute majority of situations, they are satisfied with very large margin. But there may be some situations in which it is not so clear, and one should be careful about that. In particular, if there exist relatively heavy sterile neutrinos. Okay, now I finish with this, and I go to a different topic, neutrino oscillations in matter. The famous MSW effect. The idea was first put forward by Wolfenstein in 1978, the idea that matter can affect neutrino oscillations, and was established by Mikheyev and Smirnov in 1985, that the effect may be a strong enhancement of neutrino oscillations, and actually adiabatic conversion of neutrinos of one flavor to neutrinos of different flavor, which was missed in the original Wolfenstein's paper. So matter can change the whole pattern of neutrino oscillations drastically. And resonant enhancement and resonant flavor conversion can take place. It turned out that these matter-enhanced neutrino oscillations are actually responsible for the so-called solar neutrino problem, which was with us for more than 30 years, and now it's finally solved. And the matter effects can be very important for neutrino oscillations inside the Earth, like long baseline accelerator experiments, and for neutrinos from supernovae. And here you can see the authors of this beautiful idea, Lincoln Wolfenstein, Stanislav Mikheyev, and Alexei Smirnov. Unfortunately, Wolfenstein and Mikheyev are no longer with us. Okay, so one question which immediately arises is the following. I mentioned in my first lecture that neutrinos are so weakly interacting with matter that matter hardly affect them at all. For MeV scale neutrinos, the mean free path in lead is one light year. So how can matter of the Earth or matter of the Sun affect neutrino oscillations? And the answer is very simple. When we calculate mean free path, we should take a cross-section of either neutrino capture or neutrino scattering on an appreciable angle and multiply by matter density and neutrino velocity. And this, the inverse of this gives us the mean free path. And the neutrino capture and scattering cross-section is proportional to Fermi constant squared. This means that at relatively low energies, this cross-section is very, very small. Now, the effect of matter on neutrino oscillation is related to coherent neutrino forward scattering of the particles of matter. And this effect is proportional to the first power of the Fermi constant, not to the second power. And that's why the effect may be quite large. And what matters is actually is the effective potential which is created by matter for neutrinos. And this potential turns out to be of the order of Fermi constant times the number density of the scattered particles. So what are these scatterings which are important for neutrino oscillations? There are two types of neutrino scattering on particles of matter, which are usual matter, in usual matter just electrons, protons and neutrons. There is a charge current scattering of electron neutrinos on electrons through the W boson exchange. We don't have such processes for muon and tau neutrinos in ordinary matter because ordinary matter just doesn't contain charged muons and tauons. However, in some situations like in supernovae, there's some small fraction of muon neutrinos, for example, charged muons. So for muon neutrinos, this effect may also be important. But for situations related to the matter of the sun or the earth, only electron neutrinos can undergo charge current induced scattering on electrons of matter. Also, there is a neutral current scattering through the Z boson exchange for all three neutrino flavors, electron, muon, and tau, on all particles of matter, protons, neutrons, and electrons. Strictly speaking, when we talk about scattering on protons and nucleons, we should have in mind scattering on the quarks, which are inside these protons and neutrons. Now, you remember I discussed in my previous lecture that the evolution in the simplest two-flavor case of electron and muon neutrino flavors can be described by the Schrödinger-like equation. Yesterday I wrote it in terms of the derivative over time. We can also consider derivative over the coordinate because I'm considering the approximation in which I take neutrino to be nearly point-like. So for point-like neutrino propagating on over the classical trajectory, it doesn't matter whether I take time or coordinate. And then in vacuum, this evolution equation was like this, but without matter term. In matter, there are some potentials which should be added on the diagonal of this Hamiltonian because it is written in the flavor basis, so only certain flavors have well-defined interaction with matter. So electron neutrino is described by this and partly by this, and muon tau neutrino scattering are also described by neutral current. So all of them should contribute to the diagonal of this effective Hamiltonian. However, contribution of the neutral current are exactly the same for all neutrino flavors, and this means that when we study oscillations, we can neglect them completely because they don't change the phase differences. And the only thing which matters here is the scattering of electron neutrinos on the electrons of medium, which is described by this potential here. So we have to add the matter-induced potential, and if matter density is not constant along the neutrino path, this potential also depends on the coordinate. So we have to solve now the evolution equation in which the Hamiltonian is no longer constant in general, but may depend on the coordinate as well. So the situation is more complicated. Now, what is this potential? How can we find it? The simplest way to find is the following. Consider the Hamiltonian of charge current interaction of electrons with electron neutrinos. It has a well-known form given here. At low energies, it's just a four Fermi interaction. Then it is convenient to cast it in a slightly different form by taking neutrino field here and electron field here. This is so-called first transformation. It can be done in general for any Dirac matrices here, but depending on the exact form of Dirac matrices, there may be some minus signs or whatever, but for this V minus A interaction, there is no change, no minus sign, and we just can replace this Hamiltonian by this one. They are identically equal to each other. So here we have electrons only in the first bracket and neutrinos only in the second bracket. Next thing is to notice that for nearly massless neutrinos or for neutrinos of very high energy, 1 minus gallium 5 acting on neutrino gives just a factor of 2. You remember, left-handed projector is 1 minus gamma 5 over 2. Acting by this projector, we would get just 1, factor 1. Since we don't have 1 over 2, it gives us factor of 2. So we'll find some coefficients like 2 in front of this Fermi constant divided by square root 2. Next, we want to find the potential created by electrons for neutrinos. To do this, we fix the variables related to the neutrino and average over all the variables related to the electron. And then we'll find the contribution to the effective Hamiltonian of neutrinos of this kind. Nu bar, some potential, nu. And we are interested in this potential. It is this potential which will enter the evolution equation. How can we do it? We have here E bar gamma mu 1 minus gamma 5 E, where gamma mu can be gamma 0 or gamma vector. So we have to consider all possibilities. Let's first take gamma 0 times 1. Gamma 0 times 1 gives us E bar gamma 0 E, averaged over the state of the electrons in the medium. And gamma bar gamma 0 is just E bar gamma 0 is just dagger. So we have E dagger E averaged over the state of electrons, which is just the electron number density. Okay. Now, if we take again gamma mu, but vector part of gamma mu, three vector part of gamma mu, not four vector. Okay. And forget about gamma 5 for a minute. Then this expression gives us just the average velocity of electrons. Next, consider the axial vector part, gamma 0, gamma 5, and gamma vector, gamma 5. Gamma 0, gamma 5 gives us this expression. It's the average of the helicity of electron divided by the electron energy, so it is strongly suppressed if electrons are non-relativistic. Next is gamma vector, gamma 5, which is just the average of the spin of electron. And this, if the medium contains unpolarized electrons, this average is zero. So in the unpolarized case, we just neglect this. For non-relativistic electrons in the medium, we neglect this, and we neglect this. So in the end, we are left over just with one term. And therefore, the potential created by electrons for neutrinos is just factor 2 here, which gives us square root 2 Fermi constant times the electron number density. That's what is called the Wolfenstein potential. Instead of considering this evolution equation with some effective potential, I could have considered everything in terms of the refractive index for neutrinos created by the medium. And these two descriptions are equivalent. I just consider one of them. Now, let's come back to this equation and let us first assume that this potential is constant, which would mean that neutrinos propagate in a matter of constant density, constant electron number density. In this case, it would look very similar to oscillations in vacuum, except that the mixing angle and the oscillation length will be different. They will be affected by this quantity. Okay? Still, it's very easy to find them. The mixing angle is obtained by diagonalizing this Hamiltonian. And the oscillation length is just essentially the inverse of the difference of the eigenvalues of this Hamiltonian. So it's easy to diagonalize it. You remember the rule of the thumb that any 2x2 matrix like this, the tangent of twice the mixing angle is equal to twice the off-diagonal element divided by the difference of the diagonal elements, okay? So we immediately find it. Now, the transition probability, flavor transition probability in this case will have the form similar to the oscillations in vacuum, but with sine squared 2 theta in matter and sine multiplied by sine squared pi over oscillation baseline divided by oscillation length in matter. And this mixing angle and oscillation length in matter are in general different from their vacuum values. So the sine square of twice mixed annihilated matter turns out to be given by this expression. Okay? Let us look at this. It has a typical resonance form. There is a factor here which contains sine squared 2 theta and delta m squared over 2 e squared. The same factor here. And there is a factor which may vanish if there is a certain relationship between the number density of electrons and neutrino energy and, of course, delta m squared. Okay? So if this expression in square brackets vanishes, then we will get a resonance. And the resonance would mean, assume that this is zero. Then we just have one, because the expression in the numerator and denominator will be the same. And this sine squared 2 theta is just the amplitude, maximal possible value of the oscillation probability, which is maximum value which can be achieved for certain values of the oscillation phase. Okay? So if we just plot sine squared 2 theta in matter as a function of density, number density of electrons, you will find the following picture. At zero density, sine squared 2 theta in matter will coincide with sine squared 2 theta in vacuum. You can see it immediately from here. If the density is zero, we have cosine squared plus sine squared, which gives us 1, and then delta m squared over 2e divide everything squared, so we can cancel it, and we get vacuum sine squared of the vacuum mixing angle. Okay? Now, if we start increasing the density, then we come closer to the situation when these two terms start canceling each other, and we have some increase of the oscillation amplitude, sine squared 2 theta in matter. And this increase becomes maximal at the value of mixing angle in matter equal to 45 degrees, which corresponds to vanishing term in the square brackets. So it's 1. And then if we further increase the density, then we again suppress this oscillation amplitude, and it will go at very large densities, it will go to zero again. Okay? And the condition that these two terms cancel each other is called the MSW resonance condition. If this condition is satisfied, the mixing angle in matter is equal to 45 degrees, which corresponds to the maximal mixing. Okay? And the interesting thing is that at this point, sine squared 2 theta in matter takes value 1 irrespectively of the value of the mixing angle in vacuum. So whatever mixing angle in vacuum is, at the resonance, mixing angle in matter is 45 degrees and its sine squared of double this value is 1. Okay? So one can immediately ask, what happens if we just send vacuum mixing to 0, go to the limit of 0 vacuum mixing? Shall we still have strong enhancement of oscillations in matter? So, who knows the answer? Any ideas? What happens if we go 10 to minus 20 vacuum mixing angle? We still get at resonance sine squared 2 theta in matter 1. So what happens in this case is the following. As soon as we decrease vacuum mixing angle, this peak becomes more and more narrow. The peak value is still 1, but the peak becomes more and more narrow. And in the limit, it becomes of 0 width. And this means that there is still simply no time for neutrinos to develop, neutrino oscillations to develop. Formally, the mixing angle is maximal, but the phase, oscillation phase, at resonance will become 0. So you will not see any oscillations, of course, even though formally the oscillation amplitude is equal to 1. This is actually related to what is called the Adiabaticity condition, which I will discuss later. Now, if we consider antineutrinos instead of neutrinos, then we should put the minus sign here, but the potential for them is negative of that for neutrinos. So depending on the sine on delta m squared over 2e times cosine 2 theta in vacuum, we can have the resonance either for neutrinos or for antineutrinos, but not for both of them. It depends on the sine of the right-hand side. Okay? Now, assume it is positive, then we have the resonance for neutrinos. What does it mean positive? Delta m squared is by definition here, m2 squared minus m1 squared, and cosine of 2 theta can be written as cos squared of theta minus sine squared of theta. So we say that it is, if it is positive, then we have resonance for neutrinos. But what we call m1 and m2 is a matter of convention. We can assume that m1 is bigger than m2, or we can assume that m1 is smaller than m2. So there should be some physical meaning of this condition, not just notational meaning. Notation is a matter of convention, what we call nu1, what we call nu2. Now, the physical meaning is the following. In this case, the mixing matrix in the two-flavor case is just cosine in mixing matrix in vacuum. Cosine theta, sine theta, minus sine theta, cosine theta. And the first column, as I discussed in one of my lectures, give us the content of first mass eigenstate in terms of the flavor states, nu e and nu mu. And the second column gives us the content of the second mass eigenstate in terms of nu e and nu mu. So the condition written here, m2 square minus m1 square times this difference is bigger than 1, means that in the state which is heavy, whatever we call it, nu1 or nu2, contribution of electron neutrino is bigger than the contribution of muon neutrino. Because these contributions are given by square moduli of these elements. Okay? So let's consider nu2. Nu2, so assume first that nu2 is bigger than nu1. Then nu2 is the heavier of the two states. So nu2, nu1. And its composition of its content of nu e is given by s squared. And content of nu mu by c squared. So s squared and c squared. So and in the nu1, the its content is c squared. Okay? So c squared minus s squared times m2 squared minus m1 squared bigger than zero means that the heavier state has less neutrinos than the lower state. Now, if we take a different convention, say nu2 is lighter than nu1, then of course the physical content of this statement is the same. The lower of the two states has more electron neutrinos than the heavier one. So it is in this case that we can have MSW resonance for neutrinos. Okay? Now, what happens in matter of varying density if the density is not constant along the neutrino path? Something very interesting happens. First of all, we cannot solve exactly the evolution equation anymore. It's equivalent to a Schrödinger equation with some arbitrary potential, which has no solution, no closed form solution in general. There are some special cases where you can find an exact analytic solution, like, for example, an exponential potential. But in general, Schrödinger equation with arbitrary potential cannot be solved in a closed form. So what can we do in this case? We still can learn something about neutrino oscillations if matter density changes along the neutrino path relatively slowly. I'll explain what I mean by this, relatively slowly. Okay? Let us first consider the neutrino mixing angle and matter as a function of the density of electrons. As I said, the tangent of twice of this quantity is given by the ratio of sine 2 theta, this twice of diagonal term divided by difference of the diagonal terms of the effective Hamiltonian. Now let's look at this expression. At zero density, we just get the vacuum tangent of the twice the vacuum mixing angle here. Okay? At the resonance, this becomes infinity, which means that twice the mixing angle is 90 degrees and the mixing angle itself is 45 degrees, as we already discussed. Now, if we further increase the matter density, the absolute value of tangent to theta will decrease, but the sign will be negative. So in the limit of very large density, we will have very small and negative value of tangent of 2 theta in matter, which means that theta in matter is very close to 90 degrees. So if we go from zero density to very high densities, the mixing angle goes from the vacuum value to nearly 90 degrees, passing 45 degrees at the resonance. Now let's consider, for example, situation for neutrinos produced in the sun. We assume that in the sun, the place where neutrinos are produced has very high density, which is actually the case. And this density is much bigger than the MSW resonant density. By the way, about the resonant density, there's a certain relation between the density and energy. And this may look as a fine tuning. There should be one-to-one correspondence between energy and density. However, in realistic situations, we have an energy spectrum for neutrinos. Neutrinos don't have just a single energy. And the matter density in some situations of interest is also not constant. It has some range, changes within some range. So if these two ranges are suitable, then for every energy there will be some density at which this condition is satisfied. So it's not any fine, there's no any fine tuning here. Okay. Now let's consider, as I said, situation when neutrinos are produced at densities which are much larger than the resonant density. The resonant density is given by this condition, and larger means that we are above this condition in density. As I already discussed, in this case, the mixing angle in matter is about 90 degrees. Let us look at the formula relating mass matter eigenstate with flavor eigenstate. In vacuum, we discussed relations between mass eigenstates and flavor eigenstate. And mass eigenstates are the eigenstates which diagonalize the Hamiltonian of free propagation. In matter, the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian are so-called matter eigenstates. These are again the eigenstates which diagonalize the Hamiltonian of the system, now in matter, but they are different from mass eigenstates. And the mixing angle which diagonalizes the Hamiltonian is exactly the angle which gives the relation between the flavor eigenstate and matter eigenstate, those which diagonalize the Hamiltonian. Now we can have very similar relations for matter eigenstate in terms of flavor eigenstates as we had in vacuum, except that the mixing angle should be by mixing angle we should understand the mixing angle in matter. Okay. And let us start at very high densities, like in the center of the sun. The mixing angle is 90 degrees, which means that cosine is nearly zero and sine is nearly one. And from here, from this formula, we know that what is produced in the sun are electron neutrinos, and these electron neutrinos are given by nearly coincide with the matter eigenstate 2. This is zero, cosine is zero, so electron neutrinos essentially coincide with matter eigenstate 2, with a heavier one. Now, when neutrinos propagate from the center of the sun toward the surface of the sun, the density changes, decreases. And now assume that it decreases very slowly, adiabatically. I will explain in a few minutes what I actually mean by this. In the adiabatic regime, the matter eigenstates do not go into each other. They evolve independently. The matter eigenstates nu2 will remain the matter eigenstate nu2. It will not go into nu1. If we created nu2, it will always be nu2. If we created nu1, it will always be nu1. This is the consequence of the adiabaticity. However, the mixing angle changes. It depends on the density. So the flavor composition of the matter eigenstates, nu1 and nu2, will change. So assume the adiabaticity condition is satisfied for solar neutrinos. So the state which was created as electron neutrino and which was initially nearly nu2 in matter will still remain nu2. However, its composition with respect to electron and muon neutrino will not be always the same. As we approach the surface of the sun, the density goes to zero, electron number density goes to zero, and in the end we have the mixing angle in matter equal to mixing angle in vacuum. And assume for a minute that Mixon angle in a vacuum is small. Okay? If it is small, this would mean that nu2 will be mostly composed by nu mu and not nu e when we go to small densities. If sine theta is small, cosine is nearly 1, then the same nu2 which we created and which remained nu2 will become the muon neutrino instead of electron. So we created an electron neutrino, and when it the state we created adiabatically propagates toward the surface of the sun, it is converted into muon neutrino. And this is not oscillations, this is a conversion. So instead of oscillatory behavior, we'll have a smooth transition of one neutrino flavor into another. And that's a very beautiful point about the MSW effect. Why is it so? Consider again the matter of constant density. We know that the oscillations in this case are similar to oscillations in vacuum, except that the Mixon angle is different and the oscillation length is different. And we in principle can find some density for which Mixon angle becomes very large, even maximal. Okay? However, to see a strong effect, we need our detector to be exactly at the position of the maximal of the oscillation curve. If we close to the minimum, despite an enhancement of the Mixon angle, we will not see any effect. Okay? In the case of adiabatic transition, it doesn't matter where we put our detector, because there will be no oscillation, there will be a smooth transition from one flavor to another. And if the Mixon angle in matter was small, we would have seen very strong conversion of electron neutrino into muon neutrino in this two flavor picture, irrespective of where we put our detector. So this can be pictorially represented in the following way. The energy levels of two mass eigenstates are shown here in red, meta eigenstates shown here in red. And in the absence of the mixing, there will be a level crossing. Level crossing corresponds exactly when the two diagonal terms of the neutrino Hamiltonian become equal to each other. And this is the condition where the MSW resonance condition is satisfied. The MSW resonance, if you look back at the Hamiltonian of neutrino oscillations in matter, so the MSW resonance condition is the condition when the two diagonal terms become equal to each other. Okay? And this would be the level crossing. However, because of mixing, the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian never cross. There is an avoided level crossing, so-called Landau-Zinner phenomenon, which is well known in atomic physics, for example. Okay? Now, if we create an electron neutrino at high density, it nearly coincides with nu2 in matter, second matter eigenstate. And then neutrino go from high density to the low density, to the surface of the sun. And if the adiabaticity condition is satisfied, then there are no transitions between nu2 and nu1. The state which was created as nu2 will remain nu2 forever. Okay? But its flavor composition changes, and it ends up as muon neutrino rather than electron neutrino. And you see that in the course of neutrino motion from the center of the sun to the surface of the sun, its flavor composition shown here changes slowly. So what is this adiabaticity condition? The adiabaticity condition is that the neutrino density along the neutrino path changes slowly enough. And it can be written, be written like this. Here, L rho is the scale height of neutrino density change. It's by definition, it's 1 over electron density change. 1 over density of electrons times derivative of the density along the neutrino path to the minus 1. So if the density changes very slowly, this goes to infinity. For constant matter density, this goes to infinity. And we need it to be much bigger than 1 in order for this adiabaticity condition to be satisfied. Okay? How can we see it? Well, before I do this, there's a very nice illustration of the adiabatic flavor conversion, the mechanical model. It was actually first demonstrated by Steven Weinberg at a high energy physics conference in Berkeley next year after this, the discovery of the MSW effect. So you have two pendula with some weak spring between them, and you can change the length of one of these two pendula. Okay? Assume that you kick this one and starts oscillating, but second one is nearly at rest because the spring is weak and the eigenfrequencies are quite different. The one of these two pendula is longer than the other. Okay? But then we start slowly decreasing the length of this one, if our device allows to do that. That was a mechanical device which Weinberg actually really has shown at the conference. Okay? If we, when the lengths of two pendula become equal to each other, there is a resonance. The eigenfrequencies are equal, and the second pendulum, which was originally at rest, will start oscillating with the same amplitude as the first one, which we kicked in the beginning. If we further continue decreasing the length of this one, then this pendulum will start oscillating at full amplitude, and this one will be at rest. So we converted excitation from one pendulum to another. That's a direct analog on the MSW effect. That's very beautiful mechanical analog. Actually, all oscillating systems are very similar to each other. And simple neutrino oscillations are very simple to similar to the oscillation of a pendulum. And the MSW effect has the analogy in this coupled pendulum. Okay, so this is just illustrates what I said before. Now, how can we see when the adiabaticity is good or bad and when the adiabatic conversion is possible? To do this, it's convenient to go into the instantaneous eigenstate basis, the meta-eigenstate basis. So when we diagonalize the Hamiltonian, we can do it by introducing the mixing angle, which depends on the elements of the Hamiltonian, in particular on the density of electrons. However, if the density of electrons is not constant, we cannot do it once and forever. For each point where density takes certain value, we have to do it again and again. We cannot do it once forever. So the states which diagonalize the Hamiltonian at this particular given point are called instantaneous eigenstates. However, if we introduce this evolution equation, Schrödinger-like equation, in the new basis, the basis which diagonalizes instantaneous Hamiltonian, then because of the coordinate dependence of the mixing matrix, we have to differentiate it as well, not only the neutrino state, but also the matrix. And therefore, the effective Hamiltonian of the in the new basis will not be just rotated Hamiltonian, but it will also contain the term which contains which depends on the derivative of the mixing matrix here, some extra term. And therefore, we will get in the new basis, in the basis of the instantaneous eigenstates of the neutrino Hamiltonian, the evolution equation which contains off-diagonal terms. If the meta density is not constant, the mixing angle in the meta is also not constant, and this derivative with respect to the coordinate will also be non-zero, and therefore we'll get this kind of Hamiltonian. In the limit of constant meta density, the mixing angle in meta becomes constant, and these two terms disappear, and we have then only the diagonal terms. So the adiabatic approximation is when we can neglect this off-diagonal term compared to the difference of the diagonal terms. This means that the meta density changes slowly enough, and therefore mixing angle also changes slowly enough along the neutrino trajectory. And in this case, we can neglect this derivative. What happens in this case? Assume we have zero here and zero here. Then we can actually solve the evolution equation, and the result will be given by just this formula. In meta of constant density, we will just get exponential minus I E1 x, exponential minus I E2 x. In meta of slowly changing density, instead of the product of energy and x, we have the integral of energy along the trajectory. And the result, the coefficients here are cosine and sine of mixing angle in meta at the initial point. Zero means the point where neutrinos were created. And this comes from the initial conditions. And the condition that the difference of the two diagonal terms of the Hamiltonian is much bigger than the off-diagonal term at the resonance where it is most hard to satisfy this condition, because this takes the minimum value, is given by this expression which I discussed before. So the adiabaticity condition is just the condition that we can neglect the off-diagonal term of the Hamiltonian in the matter eigenstate basis compared to the difference of the two diagonal terms. Okay. Now we can project this back on the initial state and find the survival probability of electron neutrinos, or project it back on the muon neutrino state at the final point, or at the point x, whatever it is, and find the transition probability. And if we do it, the simple calculation gives this formula. So there are terms which are independent of the coordinate and only depend, well, they depend in the coordinate in a very simple way, because the initial mixing angle corresponds to the mixing angle in matter at neutrino production point, and final mixing angle corresponds to the mixing angle at the final point at which we want to study the result of neutrino flavor transition. And of course it depends on the coordinate because the density depends on the coordinate. But it depends in a smooth way, non-oscillatory way. And the only term which has some oscillatory part is this one, because phi is the integral of the difference of two eigenstates of the neutrino Hamiltonian along the neutrino trajectory. Now, we have a smooth part and the oscillatory part. But if the matter density at neutrino production is higher than the MSW resonant density, then the mixing angle at production is 90 degrees, twice mixing angle is 180 degrees, and this term disappears. So if neutrinos are produced far above the MSW resonance point, there are no oscillations. There is a smooth transition from one flavor to another. And that's a very interesting thing. And if you just assume that final density is zero, so neutrinos propagate from high density to vacuum, then theta f is just vacuum mixing angle. And we can immediately find that in the adiabatic regime, the neutrino transition probability is given by cosine square mixing angle in vacuum, and survival probability, sine square of mixing angle in vacuum. So the smaller the mixing angle, the larger the transition probability due to this adiabatic conversion. This may look counterintuitive, because we have very small vacuum mixing, and the smaller it is, the larger the probability that neutrinos will be converted into different flavor. But we shouldn't forget that this is only true in the adiabatic regime. And the adiabaticity condition itself depends on the mixing angle. And if mixing angle becomes too small, mixing angle in vacuum, we are likely to violate this adiabaticity condition. So that gives us a natural limit of the applicability of this formula. However, it turns out for the solar neutrinos, for example, it's very well applicable. The transitions of solar neutrinos are adiabatic to a very good extent, and this formula works. Now, that's a very interesting point. And we can immediately see that why experiments confirm that the MSW effect takes place in the sun. You remember the transition probability for neutrino oscillation in vacuum, or let me write survival probability, is 1 minus sine square 2 theta sine square oscillation phase. We have to average over the neutrino production coordinate in the sun. The typical range of the production region in the sun is of the order of 10% of solar radius, which is quite a big value, and therefore the oscillation phase is fast fluctuating, and therefore we can replace it by the averaged value, which is 1 minus 1 half sine square to theta. And the minimum value is achieved if sine squared to theta is equal to 1. And it will be 1 minus 1 half, which is 1 half. This is the absolute minimum of neutrino survival probability, electron neutrino survival probability, if we just have the vacuum oscillations. What happens here with the M's double effect is sine square to theta, sorry, theta vacuum. And it can be easily less than 1 half. And actually, experiment gives us this, for this Mixnagel, nearly 30 degrees, 30 or 33 degrees, something like this. So it's smaller than 1 half. So we certainly know that there is an M's double effect in the sun, because we get a value which is below absolute possible minimum in the case of vacuum oscillations. Well, this is a confirmation, the simplest form of confirmation that what happens in the sun is the M's double effect. Okay, we can also consider the inverse situation with respect to adiabaticity, when the difference of the two terms on the diagonal are much smaller than the derivative of the mixing angle. I will not discuss it, it's very easy to find the solution in this case. I suggest it for you as an exercise. And the interesting point is that you can do it for arbitrary form of this derivative, arbitrary form of it depends on the coordinate. If you introduce a new variable, theta, instead of differentiating with respect to coordinate, you differentiate with respect to the mixing angle. Okay, now some ideas about numbers. We first know that in the case of very small matter potential, which is much smaller than delta m squared over 2e, we should recover the vacuum oscillation situation. So what is the typical value of v? This quantity can be represented as about 7.6 times 10 to minus 14 electron volt times matter density in grams per cubic centimeter and the electron number fraction per baryon, which is the number of electrons divided by the sum of the numbers of protons and neutrons. For the sun, it's close to about 0.8 on average. So typically, for the Earth, it's very close to 1 half. So these are values of order 1. So we have typical values of matter-induced potential for neutrinos of the order of 10 to minus 14 electron volt for densities of order 1 grams per cubic centimeter. So it's an extremely small quantity. But we have to compare it with delta m squared over 2e, which is also an extremely small quantity. And as we know, the M's double resonance means that these two quantities are nearly the same, up to the cosine of twice mixing angle in vacuum. If we consider very low energies, then we have the situation when delta M squared over 2e is much bigger than potential, and we recover the vacuum situation. However, the vacuum situation is recovered also in the case of large v, if we consider neutrino oscillations over short distances. In this case, we can expand here. This is the formula for matter, and omega is essentially the quantity which was in the denominator of sine square of twice mixing angle in matter. Okay, so in matter of constant density, it has this form, and if we have very short baseline experiment, we can expand this sign, and then the omega here, omega square, this expression is sine square of twice mixing angle in matter. And omega square from here will cancel, and we will get the same result as in vacuum. So even if the matter potential is much bigger than delta m square over 2e, you will not see it at short distances. The oscillation probability is exactly the same as in vacuum. And this was for matter of constant density, but it can be shown that it is the general result. It doesn't depend on whether matter density is constant or not along the neutrino trajectory. Another very interesting and nice representations of neutrino oscillations in matter. Let's consider a vector, the components of which are real parts of nu E star, nu mu, which nu E and nu mu are the amplitudes of finite neutrino of given flavor. Imaginary part of this and nu E star, nu E minus 1/2. And another vector, which describes the neutrino Hamiltonian, the components of which are delta m square over 4e times sine, twice mixing angle in vacuum, zero, and v over 2, the half of the Wolfenstein potential, minus delta m square over 4e cosine, twice mixing angle in vacuum. And if we write down the Schrödinger evolution equation in terms of this vector, the result will be just this. This is familiar formula, it's so-called Bloch equation for spin precession in an external magnetic field. So the evolution of neutrino flavor can be represented as a precession of a spin around an external magnetic field, the properties of which depend on the neutrino Hamiltonian, actually. So what happens is the following. The projection on the z-axis give us the probability of finding electron neutrino or muon neutrino, depending on whether it is positive or negative. And the precession is the precession is around an axis which has the angle 2 theta compared to the z-axis. So this is the direction of B. So this is the precession, and the projection of this vector, the spin vector S here, onto the z-axis give us the probability of finding neutrino of electron flavor, for example. So it's clear that it will oscillate in this range. Now, if the mixing angle becomes maximum, so the axis B goes to the horizontal axis X, and the precession will be with maximum amplitude, with amplitude 1. So we may have full transition of one flavor into another, but again, it's an oscillatory transition. Now, what happens if meta density is not constant? Then the mixing angle is not constant, which means that the direction of the axis B here is not constant. It changes when the meta density changes. And for example, with decreasing meta density, this axis B starts going downwards. And if it goes slowly enough, the flavor spin vector continues processing around changing position, and in the end can completely flip in the opposite direction, which means a complete transition from electron flavor to muon flavor. Okay. And the condition, the adiabaticity condition, is the condition that the change, the rate with which the direction of vector B changes is small compared to the oscillation frequency around this field. Only in this condition, the precession will trace the position of the axis B. Otherwise, the flavor spin will lag behind this. If this B axis changes very quickly, the flavor spin doesn't follow it. And this is adiabaticity violation. And if we calculate the oscillation or survival probability for neutrinos in the sun, we will find that its energy dependence, actually dependence on E over delta M square, has the form of the so-called bathtub. So on the left we have low energy, which means that oscillations are nearly of vacuum nature, and depending on the mixing angle in vacuum, if it is small we have this situation, if it is larger we have this situation, and the survival probability is just 1 minus 1/2 sine square 2 theta, as I explained. Here we have the adiabatic conversion in meta-induced neutrino flavor transition. And the survival probability here is given by sine square theta vacuum, which is either small for small mixing or larger for larger mixing, but it's always sine square 2 theta. And for larger energies, we lose adiabaticity, and then we again go to the non-adiabatic regime, where the survival probability is again given by the same formula. So this is what we expect as a survival probability for the solar neutrinos. Well, one interesting effect is, which is related to the matter-induced oscillation, is the following. Consider a terrestrial detector for the solar neutrinos, and consider the signal which we observe during day and during a night. During night, neutrinos propagate path of the trajectory inside the Earth. So they experience oscillations which are affected not only by the solar matter, but also by the Earth matter. And I discussed in one of my previous lectures that neutrinos of astrophysical origin lose their coherence on the way to the detector. This is exactly what happens with solar neutrinos. Solar neutrinos arrive at the Earth as an incoherent superposition of nu 1, nu 2, and with small admixture of nu 3 in general. Okay? And if there was no matter of the Earth, such states wouldn't oscillate. When we create such a state, it will remain itself, because mass eigenstates do not oscillate in vacuum. However, when mass eigenstates enter the Earth, they are no longer the states which diagonalize the Hamiltonian, because matter eigenstates do not oscillate in matter. And therefore, there are still flavor transitions even for mass eigenstates nu 1 and nu 2 when they enter the Earth. It's easy to calculate the probability of finding electron neutrinos after they traverse some distance in the Earth before they reach the detector. And what happens is that there's a partial recovery of electron neutrino flux. Typically, we expect during day some suppression of the electron neutrino flux because of flavor conversion. But during night, it is partially recovered. So the signal during night should be bigger than the signal during day. However, how much bigger? It depends on the neutrino parameters. And for those which are now known to describe the solar neutrino oscillation, the effect is quite small. It's only about 2% increase. And therefore, it wasn't easy to find it. And only relatively easy, relatively recently, it was observed only at 3 sigma level now. But still, it's a good indication that this regeneration of electron neutrinos in the Earth takes place. So this is the calculation of this effect. I will skip it. You can look it up in my lectures, which will be posted. Another possible matter effect is, I will skip this at all, this is a parametric resonance in neutrino oscillations. Matter effects may be not only because of the level crossing, but some different of some different nature related to a certain relationship between the oscillations amplitude and phases. And in principle, one can have enhancement of neutrino oscillations even if you are far away from the EMS double resonance conditions. But this is one example of this is called parametric resonance of neutrino oscillations. And the mechanical analog of this is the following. If you have a pendulum with vertically oscillating support point, that if there is a certain relation between the frequency of this oscillation of support point and eigenfrequency of the pendulum, it goes upside down and starts oscillating near the vertical equilibrium point, which otherwise would be unstable. So that's well known. You can find it in textbook of mechanics by Landau and Lifshitz, for example. Okay. And there is an analog of this in neutrino oscillations, which is called parametric resonance. But I don't have time to discuss this. Some possible manifestations. Okay, 3 neutrino oscillations in matter. If we have 3 neutrino oscillations, the evolution equation should be like this. Again, we can only take into account the matter-induced potential for electron neutrinos and neglect it for muon and tau neutrinos because they are the same for all 3 neutrino species. This equation can be simplified if we take the standard parameterization of the leptonic 3x3 mixing matrix. But again, I don't have time to discuss this point. And now I want to discuss some general properties of neutrino oscillation probabilities related to unitarity and some other symmetries of these probabilities. Okay? First of all, irrespectively of whether we consider neutrino oscillations in vacuum or in matter, they should satisfy unitarity conditions. In the three-flavor case, these are nine conditions given by the sum of P alpha beta over all beta equal to 1, and similar conditions if we sum this probability over alpha. So the probability of that neutrino of flavor alpha will go to all possible flavors, including remaining in the same flavor, is equal to 1. Less obvious, but still it's true, that the probability of all possible initial flavors to become flavor beta also sum to 1. This is related to the fact that they are described by the evolution matrix, which is unitary. And unitarity works so not only S dagger S, where S is evolution matrix, is equal to 1, but also S S dagger is equal to 1. Okay. So there are nine conditions, but only six conditions, but only five of them are independent. And out of all nine 3x3 oscillation probability for neutrinos, we have five unitarity conditions. So only four probabilities remain independent in this case. And similar for antineutrinos, of course. Okay. Now let's now consider oscillations in general in matter. It can be in particular in vacuum, but in general matter. So we have the matter potential, the matrix of matter potential, if we have to add to the Hamiltonian of neutrino flavor evolution of this type. Now you see there's only one non-zero element, and therefore rotations in the 2-3 plane do not affect it. So the rotation with mixing angle theta 2-3 doesn't affect the part of the Hamiltonian which is responsible for the matter effect. And if we take this into account, we find some more symmetries. If we define, this is just a definition, P twiddle alpha beta is P alpha beta in which we replace sine square of theta 2-3 by cosine and vice versa, and sine theta 2-3 by minus sine theta 2-3, which is, by, for example, achieved if we go from theta 2-3 to theta 2-3 plus 90 degrees, then we can easily find that the oscillation probability P e tau is equal to P e mu twiddle, P tau mu is to P mu tau twiddle, and P tau tau is P mu mu twiddle. So out of the out of the three conditions, only two are independent. So we end up with two independent oscillation probabilities, which can be taken, for example, to be P e mu and P mu tau. So all the other oscillation probabilities in the three-flavor case can be fully expressed through these two. And that's very useful if we do some calculations. We don't have to recalculate again and again all of them. Next, how about antineutrinos? For antineutrinos, we have to replace delta Cp into minus delta Cp and V to minus V, because for antineutrinos, the sign of the matter-induced potential is opposite. And again, if we have analytic formulas which depend on matter potential on delta Cp phase, we can just flip their signs and get the result for antineutrinos. Okay, Cp and Cpt can also be expressed in terms of changing the signs of Cp violating phase and V. And for time reversal, we also need to exchange the density profile to the one which is a mirror image with respect to the midpoint of neutrino production. So time reversal can be caused in matter not only by delta Cp, like it is in vacuum, but also by matter potential. Assume the matter potential between the neutrino source and detector is like this. Then it is symmetric with respect to the midpoint. So when we do time reversal, it doesn't change. However, if the potential is like this, for example, then when we do the time reversal, it becomes like this. And it's a different one. So matter potential, which is not symmetric, can induce some fake time violation, just as well as matter itself can induce fake Cp violation. What do I mean by fake? It is a Cp violating difference in the oscillation probability, which has nothing to do with the fundamental properties of neutrinos, but just a consequence of the fact that matter, the usual matter in which neutrinos propagate, consists of particles and not of equal number of particles and antiparticles. Therefore, this is an extrinsic CP violation by external conditions. It doesn't have anything to do with the properties of neutrino, but just with experimental conditions. However, they will lead to the fact that the oscillation probabilities for neutrinos and antineutrinos will not be the same. So they mimic CP violation, and we have to deal with this. And for time reversal violation, the same will be the case if the density profile is not symmetric with respect to the midpoint of neutrino propagation trajectory. And that's one thing which actually makes more difficult measurement of CP violating phase in accelerator experiments. In particular, it turns out that the experiments with shorter baseline, in which there is less matter between the source and the detector, are better suited for measuring CP violating phase than the experiment with long baseline. And experiments with long baseline, on the other hand, are better suited for uncovering the type of neutrino mass ordering, because the neutrino mass ordering depends, the MSW effect depends on the neutrino mass ordering. Depending on the mass ordering, normal or inverted, will have MSW resonance either for neutrinos or for antineutrinos. And therefore, matter is useful for determining the neutrino mass ordering through the MSW effect. And therefore, experiments with longer baseline are better suited for measuring the neutrino mass ordering. Okay, I'll skip all of this because of lack of time and go to something else. Well, I was planning to go at least at some detail through the results of solar reactor accelerator experiments and discuss their outcome. But I decided to change the plan because probably I will not have much time for this discussion. But there is something which I certainly would like to discuss, a very recent result on neutrino coherent elastic scattering on nuclei. So I will do this, and then the rest of the time, whatever I have, I will try to explain at least some of the results of the oscillation experiments, or will simply show you the results of the global fit, which actually summarizes all this result in a concise form. Okay. Just 2 weeks ago, in the Science magazine, the results of the first observation on coherent electron nucleus scattering by the coherent calibration was reported. This was something which was predicted 43 years ago, but observed only now. So what is this? Consider neutrino nucleus scattering mediated by neutral currents. This is just nu plus A into nu plus A. And experimentally, we can only observe it by observing the recoil of the nucleus. By the way, this is exactly the same what we observe in the direct dark matter detection experiment, the recoil of the nucleus. So let's look at this. The situation with the cross-section of this process depends very much on the momentum transfer in this reaction. If the momentum which is transferred from the initial neutrino to the nucleus is large, then this means that the coordinate scale on which we can probe the structure of the nucleus is very small. We can see effects on individual nucleons in the nucleus, and each of them contributes to this scattering cross-section, and the total cross-section is proportional to the number of all these scatterers in the nucleus. Now, consider now the situation in which the momentum transfer is very small. If it is smaller than the inverse radius of the nucleus, then the process will fill the nucleus as a whole, which means that we will not know on which exactly nucleon neutrino scattered, And therefore, we have to add not the probabilities of neutrino scattering, but the amplitudes of neutrino scattering. As a result, the cross-section, which is proportional to the square of this probability, will be proportional not to the number of scatterers in the nucleus, but the square of the number. And for having enough nuclei, this is a huge enhancement factor. So the cross-section of this effect should be much bigger than the cross-section of the usual neutrino nucleon scattering, the incoherent scattering. So why wasn't it observed up to now? The reason for this is that you need to observe very small momentum transfer. And small momentum transfer to a heavy nucleus means even smaller energy, recoil energy of the nucleus. And very small recoil energies are very difficult to observe. That's the main point. However, now the technology doesn't stand on the same place, it moves forward. And especially due to the interest to dark matter, in which this kind of enhancement is important for the detection of dark matter particles, it is important also to look at what happens with neutrinos. Not only because we can have detectors which are very small. Typically, neutrino detectors are tens of kilotons. And here we are talking about neutrino detectors which are tens of kilograms. So it's a huge advantage. But also it is important because there is an irreducible contribution of neutrino signals from the sun and from the atmosphere to the dark matter detection experiment. This is what is called neutrino floor. And in order to be sure that we understand well what to expect, we have to check how this elastic coherent scattering happens with neutrinos first. Do we really understand well what we expect to see with neutrinos in this case?
Yeah? What is the source of these neutrinos?
Sorry?
What is the source of these neutrinos that were scattering coherently with the nuclei?
Oh, all three neutrino species. You mean electron, muon, and tau?
No, I mean, where are they coming from?
It doesn't matter where they're coming from. However, experimentally, there's several, only few sources which are suitable for this. Okay, and I'll discuss it in a minute. Okay? So, what is the prediction of the standard model? The cross-section, differential cross-section of this process is given by this expression. Theta is scattering angle. This is Weinberg angle, Z is the number of protons, N number of nucleons, and F square is a so-called form factor, nuclear form factor, which I will discuss in a few minutes. Okay? Now, we know the value of the Weinberg angle at relatively large energies, and we think we know it relatively well from theory at low energies, but it would be also good to measure it at very low energies, which we don't have. I mean, the experiment of this kind we don't have now. And that's one more reason why the experiment with coherent elastic neutrino nuclear scattering are interesting. They allow us to probe the Weinberg angle at extremely low energies. Okay? Now, from what we know about Weinberg angle, sine square of this angle is very close to 1/4. And therefore, this factor, 4 times sine square theta Weinberg minus 1, is strongly suppressed compared to 1, and therefore the contribution of protons is also strongly suppressed. And mainly the effect comes because of the neutrons. Okay? And if the coherence condition is satisfied, coherence condition in this case, as usual, coherence condition is the condition under which we add amplitudes and not probabilities. So here the coherence condition is the momentum transfer is small compared to the inverse radius of the nucleus. Okay? So if it is satisfied, this form factor is very close to 1. However, if it is slightly violated, it becomes strongly model dependent, which we don't really know. There are some models only. There are also some experimental results. But we don't have a very reliable information on this form factor if Q square is not very small. But if it is small, then we get the proportionality to the squared number of neutrons. Here, for some elements, we have the atomic numbers and the radius of or nucleus can be found as approximately 1.25 Fermi times cubic root of atomic number. So for some elements, it's given here. Now, the experiment I'm going to discuss next, the coherent experiment, uses the cesium iodine detector. And the atomic number of both of them is cesium and iodine is very close to 130. So here we find immediately that the radius is about 4.5 Fermi. From here we can find the condition, the borderline for the coherence condition, Q times R is equal to 1. And this corresponds to Q approximately 26 MeV. If this is the momentum transfer, what will be the recoil energy of a nucleus? Recoil energy is Q squared over 2m. Because this is the momentum transferred to the nucleus. Nucleus is non-relativistic. And ma. And ma is approximately 939 MeV times A, the atomic number. So if we calculate this number, we will find that the borderline for this adiabaticity corresponds to recoil energy of order of 3 keV. Very small one. This gives you immediately an idea of why it was so difficult to observe this. The recoil energies are very, very small. Okay, that's just the discussion of possible momentum transfer. The momentum transfer, the maximum momentum transfer to the nucleus is twice the momentum of the neutrino, if neutrino scatters backward. Okay? And the average momentum transfer is about one third of the of momentum transfer calculated into the energy, recoil energy of the nucleus, about one third of the maximal one. So this is what we expect to have for the recoil energy of the nucleus. Now I'll skip some experimental things. The sources. There are several sources which are being discussed. Pion decay interest is one source at some accelerators or some facilities which produce neutrino beams in pulses. It's very important to suppress the background, to have certain non-trivial time structure of the flux. And this allows us to suppress the background by a very big number. Okay? Then there are reactor neutrinos, which are very interesting because the energies are very small. 4 MeV is a perfect energy for this kind of experiment. Radiative sources and natural sources, but for them it's a bit complicated because of the absence of clear time structure, which is impossible, makes it impossible to suppress the background. So the most important are this one and these two. So the typical decay and rest experiment is the experiment in which we have a beam of protons hitting a target which produce pi minus and pi plus. Pi minus get immediately captured on a nucleus. Pi plus can decay into mu plus and muon neutrino. And muon neutrino also decays with emission of electron neutrino and muon antineutrino. And they are characterized by certain delay times. And these delay times, the time structure, is extremely important experimentally to suppress the background. And the most important, most dangerous background in the experiment which I'm going to discuss next is neutrons, actually. So the experiment coherent observes neutrinos coming from the neutron spallation source. Neutron spallation source was it's in Oak Ridge in the US, and it was used to produce neutron beams for various purposes. By the byproduct of this is a production of pions, which produce neutrinos. It was actually not the main goal of this source. However, it was realized that the time structure of the signals of neutrino is perfect for disentangling neutrinos and neutrons, which are produced by recoil recoil on the target, or neutrons knocked out for example from the lead shielding of this experiment. Well, I'm not a big expert on the experimental issues, therefore maybe my discussion of this is very fragmentary and I better skip this, but what are the advantages of measuring this coherent elastic neutrino nucleus scattering? Okay. First of all, to discover a new effect which is predicted by the standard model but has never been detected before, observed before. Second, it allows us to have very small neutrino detectors, kilograms instead of kilotons. Then, to check our understanding of neutrino nucleus scattering is important for understanding the neutrino floor for the dark matter experiments. And also, once we establish that we understand well this effect, we can use it to probe non-standard neutrino interactions, sterile neutrinos, neutrino magnetic moment, and many other things. So it's a full range of interesting things. On top of that, there are some astrophysical implications, because neutrino nucleon elastic scattering is supposed to have an important role for neutrino transport in supernovae and in neutron stars. So it's good understanding is also very important for understanding the processes in these stars. Okay, the form factor, which I discussed before. The form factor for protons or neutrons is 1 over total number of protons and neutrons times the Fourier integral of the coordinate distribution of protons and neutrons inside the nucleus. If QR is much less than 1, this is just gives us the total number of protons and neutrons. So after we divide by this number, we get just 1. However, if QR is not small, we have to take into account, expand this expression, take higher order terms into account, and this becomes model dependent. And we don't really understand the nucleus to very high accuracy. So that's a little bit of a problem for the predictions in this situation. So first of all, it is good to have small QR in order to have full coherence, otherwise we only have partial coherence. And second, it is good because then we have practically no model dependence on nuclear physics. Okay, now the coherent experiment, the result which was published 2 weeks ago. This was done at this spallation neutron source which I discussed in Oak Ridge, and the results were reported in the paper in Science and also in the talk by Phil Barbour. And the number of expected events for the experimental setting which they used was 173 plus or minus 48. You see the error is quite big. And this is related to the fact that in the experiment, QR is of order 1. It's not much less than 1, actually. And the number of events detected is 134 plus or minus 22. This was during the time period of 15 months. And the mass of the detector was only about 15 kilograms. It's the first time that neutrino detector is that small. It's really very impressive. And the conclusion was that they report 6.7 sigma significance for an excess of events that agrees with the standard model prediction to within 1 sigma. Well, one interesting plot is here. This is a comparison of cross sections of different processes. The red one is the usual inverse beta decay, which is used for detection of reactor neutrino. There are some other processes inverse beta decay on the nuclei, and all these are incoherent processes. And these dotted and dashed lines here are the coherent processes on cesium and iodine, which have very similar atomic numbers, and therefore the curves are very similar. And this is in units and 10 to minus 38 square centimeter, which is a huge cross section for weak interaction, for neutrino interaction. Okay, and you see that the difference between the cross section may be several orders of magnitude, depending on which cross section you consider. So this is the experimental facility, and this is the detector. Look at this. A handheld neutrino detector. Really impressive. Okay, and this is the signal, beam off, beam on. You can clearly see the signal here. They made a huge effort to suppress the background, and using the time and energy structure, they suppressed it by about five orders of magnitude. And this is the result prediction of the standard model with the one sigma range. And this is what they observed, actually, within one sigma of the experimental prediction. Okay, so I finish with this. If you have questions, please ask, but not about the experimental details, please. Okay, otherwise I started 15 minutes later, so I still have 10 minutes or so. And I don't have really time to discuss much of the experimental result, so I directly go to, oh, I did something wrong. Okay, I think. So I will directly go to the global fits, which actually summarize the results of all solar reactor accelerator experiments and the atmospheric experiment. I skip direct neutrino mass measurement, double beta decay, unfortunately. Oh no, I should open another file. This will all be posted, so you will see this result, of course, without my comments. No, again wrong. So global fits. So if we summarize all the experiment, we can make a global fits of all the parameters within the three flare picture. And first is broad brush picture. The solar delta M squared, the smaller one, is of the order of 7 times 10 to minus 5 electron volt squared. The atmospheric delta M squared, is, which is also measured at accelerators, is about 30 times bigger. And there are three mixing angles. Two of them are relatively large. Sine squared 2 theta is of order, sine squared theta 1, 2, sorry, of order 0.3. For theta 2, 3, it's of order 1 half. And sine squared of theta 1, 3 is about 2%. It's small, but not terribly small, which is very fortunate for studying, for example, CP violation and other things. Okay? And there are two possibilities for neutrino mass ordering. The normal ordering, where the heavy state is the one separated by a larger gap is the heaviest one, and the inverted ordering where it is downstairs. So the results of the global fates. First, the parameters which are already known. And these are the result of long baseline accelerator experiment, SOLAR, long baseline reactor experiment, Camland, short baseline reactor experiment, and atmospheric neutrinos. And delta M squared capital, this here is defined as average, arithmetic average of delta M squared 3.1 and 3.2. So for the solar neutrino mass square difference, we get the curve which gives us 1 sigma, 2 sigma, 3 sigma ranges here. And for large mass square difference, which is atmospheric and accelerator one, it depends on the ordering slightly. The normal ordering is always blue and inverted ordering is red. And this is the value we obtain. These are known quantities now. The same is true for the three mixing angles. What theta 1, 2, this is what we obtain here. Theta 1, 3 is given here. And theta 2, 3, there are essentially two possibilities with two minima of the curve which correspond to the normal ordering, blue one, and inverted mass ordering, red one, which gives different octant of theta 2, 3. The best fit value is no longer at 45 degrees, but either smaller or larger than 45 degrees, even though by not by much. And this depends on the neutrino mass ordering. However, you can see that, for example, in the case of the inverted ordering, the difference between the momenta is not so big. So it's only slight preference for one octant over the other. And the octant which is preferred is different for the normal hierarchy and for the inverted hierarchy. Now, what are the typical accuracies? For the solar delta M squared, it's about 2%. For the atmospheric, it's more or less the same order of magnitude. For the mixing angles, the best known mixing angle is now the one which was not known until relatively recently. Theta 1,3 is now the best known one. And for theta 1,2 and theta 1,3, they're both of order of 5%. And the worst known angle is the first actually measured, is the atmospheric mixing angle. Yes, please. Slightly prefer.
The behavior of the plot is totally different from the other two. Is there a reason for this?
That's just a result of all the experiments. Okay. It's not easy to pinpoint one single reason for this. It's mostly a combination of accelerator and atmospheric experiments which gives this. And this picture actually, you see the differences here between the minima of chi-square value are not very big. So it's only some hint of preferences that normal ordering is preferred, normal ordering prefers first octant for theta 2, 3, and the inverted ordering prefers the second octant. Here the difference is not so big. Here it's bigger, but we don't know the ordering yet. Okay. More on about known parameters. Here you can show how adding new data, more and more data, allows one to make the prediction more accurate. So if we have long baseline accelerator and solar and Camland data, and then add short baseline experiment, the range for delta M squared, the big one, atmospheric, becomes slightly smaller, and plus with atmospheric it becomes even a little bit smaller. So we have more accurate prediction. And here, this is this was for the normal ordering, and this is for the inverted ordering. So the outcome of all neutrino experiment gives the best prediction, but we can also consider them in some groups separately. Similar thing if we consider sine squared theta 2, 3, long baseline, solar, and Camland, then we add reactor, then this gives a drastically increased accuracy of measurement of theta 1, 3 for the normal ordering and for the inverted. Short baseline experiment especially drastically reduced this. Now unknown parameters. Delta Cp, the octant of theta 2, 3, and the ordering. Okay? So we see that delta Cp prefers now for both normal and inverted ordering values close to 1.5 pi. However, the preference is of the order only of about 2.5 sigma. Okay. What, and so it is an interesting hit, but it is not a proof, but of course, that delta Cp is non-zero and it has this value. So if we add to long baseline solar encampment, we add short baseline experiment, the preference becomes bigger. And with atmospheric, it is even bigger, especially for the normal ordering. For theta 2, 3, we are interested especially in whether it is in the first or second octant. The value at 45 degrees is now disfavored at the value close to 2 sigma now. But again, depending on the ordering, we have either preference for the first octant or the second octant. And what is interesting now, that if we combine all these three data sets, then the preference of the normal ordering over the inverted ordering becomes close to 3.6 sigma, which is already quite interesting. It was, even a year ago, it was less pronounced. Now, let's compare what is now and with what was a year ago. You see that the trends are the same. Cp seems to be close to, Cp phase seems to be close to 3.5 of pi. Ordering, normal ordering is slightly preferred, and depending on the ordering, either the first or second octant is slightly preferred. This is now, and this is what was a year ago. You see, the tendencies are the same, but the difference, the depth of the minima of chi-square was smaller. This is now. So it doesn't, it's relatively stable. It doesn't change by adding some more data obtained during last year. But it, also the confidence level of this result becomes larger. Okay, this is for the quantity which enters into the double beta decay, neutrinos double beta decay. This is what is allowed for normal and inverted hierarchy as a function of sum over all masses. If we add the experimental limits from double beta decay, it puts the upper limit on this quantity here. And in principle, we should put also the horizontal line, which corresponds to the cosmological limit on the sum of neutrino masses. But these limits depend very much on what we assume in cosmology. So different assumptions lead to quite different upper limits on the sum of all neutrino masses. And altogether, we now have the difference between the inverted and normal hierarchy of the order of 2 sigma. 3.6 sigma, which I mentioned before, was a chi-squared, actually. And no, not sigma. 3.6 was the chi-squared. Okay. So the summary of the three-flavor analysis, we now enter precision era. We have very good accuracies for all the parameters. The trends for unknown parameters survive. And the status of constraints of double beta decay in cosmology is we have now sub-EV sensitivity. And oscillation and non-oscillation global analysis corroborates normal ordering with respect to the inverted one at one sigma level. And there are some good prospects in future experiment to get a better handle on these parameters which we don't know yet, including the nature of the neutrino mass hierarchy. Okay, so what I unfortunately have to skip is sterile neutrino. That's also a very interesting thing, but it's also a very controversial one. There are a number of experiments which hint into possible existence of sterile neutrinos with mass of order of 1 electron volt. These results can be fit to some extent in the four-flavor picture of neutrino oscillations with three usual neutrino mass eigenstate, and the fourth one described by 4 by 4 matrix, And for in the leading approximation, short baseline experiment, only the fourth column and the first line important for these experiments. And we can find out the oscillation probability and try to fit all the data. And there are many experiments which put limits on this. These are oscillation experiment at accelerators, short baseline, short baseline reactor neutrino experiments, and also the experiments with ice cube deep core. And all these experiments constrain quite significantly the allowed range of parameters for the fourth neutrino flavor state, which is a sterile flavor state. And only a small range of the previously allowed parameter range survives. So there is some tension. One cannot say that we excluded the electron volt sterile neutrino, but there is certain tension between, especially between the neutrino disappearance and neutrino appearance experimental data. Okay. One thing which I skip is possibility of measuring neutrino ordering at reactor, long baseline reactor experiment, Juna and Kamland, again because of lack of time. And I will finish with a couple of slides. So we already learned a lot about neutrinos, but the road wasn't always straight and simple. There are many wrong results, and that's very kind of useful to keep in mind, that neutrino experiments are very, very complicated, and one should be very careful with the data of these experiments. This is a list of wrong neutrino experiments here. So it's not complete, by the way. It started with S and T version of weak interactions rather than V and A observed in the BNL data in 53 and 55. Then there was a claim of discovery of neutrino oscillation at Bugey experiment in 1980, and one of the others was Fretrines. And I guess this, the fact that this was a wrong claim delayed his Nobel Prize. Then there was a claim of 30 electron volt neutrino mass in tritium beta decay experiment in ITEP in Moscow in 80 and 87 experiments. A claim by Avignoni and collaborators, Pacific National Laboratory and University of South Carolina, of Majorana emission and double beta decay, which also turned out to be wrong. The wrong claim of discovery of 17 keV neutrinos in three different nuclei in Gulf, Oxford and Berkeley in 85-91. Karman time distribution anomaly. Time variation of M square in tritium beta decay in Troitsk. Opera faster than light neutrinos, which you may still remember. It was already during your lifetime as physicist. And probably I should add here the claim of neutrinos double beta decay by Klapdor. And the lesson from this is that neutrino experiments are difficult. The caution is advised. So we don't know many things, but we are going to know them. The nature of neutrinos, whether they are Dirac or Majorana, the absolute mass scale, the mass ordering, Dirac CPV phase, CPV violating phase, Majorana phase, which may contribute to the double beta decay, the existence of light sterile neutrinos, and we also would like to study more precisely the MSW resonance and parametric resonance matter effects, improve our knowledge of the known parameters, improve our knowledge of the solar production, which we can learn about with neutrinos, solar energy production, metallicity, study metal-dominated, vacuum-dominated transition in stellar neutrinos, which I didn't have time to discuss, and study or put some limits on non-standard neutrino interactions, including neutrino magnetic moments, mass-varying neutrinos, and things like this. Of course, we have something to do on the theory side. We have to develop some neutrino models which would describe and explain neutrino masses and mixings. And actually, the problem now is that not that we don't have neutrino models, but that we have too many of them. And there is no clear leader, not clear leading principle, which would allow us to say, that's it, unfortunately. To have better theory of neutrino oscillation and flavor probabilities, including non-standard interaction, Lorentz violation, CPT violation effects, mass-varying neutrinos. There are some actually more exotic ideas, neutrino tomography of the Earth, Mills-Bauer effect with neutrinos, neutrinos for more extragalactic communication and communication with submarines. You can find even papers on that. The explanation of neutrino mass through the Chisholm mechanism allows us to have a very nice baryogenesis mechanism, baryogenesis through leptogenesis. And finally, sublinear effects on neutrino oscillations and interesting constraints are being obtained. The fundamental questions of neutrino oscillation theory, surprisingly, 60 years after the suggestion of neutrino oscillations and about 20 years after the discovery of neutrino oscillation, there are still debates about some basic questions of neutrino oscillation theory. And the ultimate goal is to unravel the physics underlying the neutrino mass generation. And probably there'll be more surprises. Neutrinos always present us with more and more surprises. And neutrino revolution continues. Okay, thank you.